risen indeed. And for that, we say thank you, God. I'm James Keeton, the senior pastor here at Morris Brown AME Church, here on the beautiful peninsula of Charleston, South Carolina. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to our Easter online worship experience. Here at Morris Brown, our vision is to be a Christ-centered church, glorifying God by serving the spiritual, social, and economic needs of a diverse community. It is our prayer that the Lord will continue to bless us on this beautiful resurrection morning. Amen.
Come on, clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands this morning. Come on, clap your hands this morning. Come on, clap your hands.
Jesus, we thank you for being able to gather virtually on this morning. We thank you that even in the midst of a pandemic, that your church continues to celebrate your resurrection. We thank you, God, for your resurrection from the dead. And we know that just the way that there was an empty tomb on that Easter morning, that there's nothing that we go through in life that you weren't able to bring life out of dead situations. And so, God, continue to encourage us today as we continue to deal with the pandemic, as we continue to deal with so many conflicts and concerns in the world. We confess today that you are Lord. And we thank you, God, that we have you to go to, that you love us enough, that you have entered into a relationship with us. And for that, we say thank you. Bless these moments of worship. Let everything that we say and do here today be pleasing in your sight. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Colossians, Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, reading from the New Revised Standard Version. So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Amen. Because he has risen from the dead. Let us pray together. God, we thank you for this preaching moment. Let the words in my mouth, the meditation of each and every heart, be acceptable in your sight. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson today will be taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 11 through 18. Reading from the New Revised Standard Version, it reads this way. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned around and said in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. And Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And she told them all the things that he had said to her. For just a moment this morning, I want to preach on the subject, looking for the crucified, but leaving with the commission. Looking for the crucified, but leaving with a commission. I remember once I was hanging out with some friends, and we had gone out for the evening, and we decided that we were going to IHOP to get something to eat. We gave directions to the restaurant, and each of us drove our own vehicles to get there. Three of us arrived at the restaurant about the same time, but our fourth friend, it took him much longer. Finally, he showed up, and we asked him what took so long to get there, and the response that he gave that night was unforgettable. Our friend said that he kept driving past the restaurant because he was looking for a sign that said IHOP. But the sign on this particular location read, International House of Pancakes. At once we erupted in laughter because we could not believe that he didn't know that IHOP was simply an acronym for International House of Pancakes. And even now, as I think back on that event, I can't help but laugh. My friend, it's interesting that he arrived at the right location. He was at the right restaurant. He was reading the right sign, but he was unaware that he was exactly where he was supposed to be. As we gather to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ on this Easter morning, something like this is going on in this passage. That the text says in verse 11, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb as she wept, she bent over as she looked in the tomb. It's here that we find Mary Magdalene weeping outside of the tomb of Jesus. She's upset because when she arrives at the tomb, she finds the stone rolled away. Mary tells Simon Peter and the disciple who loved Jesus that the stone was removed. And the two disciples raced to the tomb and they went in and all they found were the linen wrappings that they used to cover the body of Jesus. When these two disciples do not find the body of Christ, they return to their homes because they can't understand the realities of the resurrection. But Mary stays. As she weeps, she finally gets enough nerve to look inside the tomb for herself. And it's in this next verse when Mary looks into the tomb, she does not find the body of Jesus. But Mary sees two angels. One of the angels sitting where the head of Jesus used to rest, and the other located where his feet were located. And it's in verse 13 that we fully begin to understand the dilemma of Mary because she says, and she looked at these angels, and the angel said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, they have taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him. Notice that the angels asked Mary why she's weeping. The question suggests that the angels cannot understand why she's weeping in sorrow after the Lord she loves has been risen from the dead. Instead of her having joy, Mary is weeping bitterly. The reason for her weeping becomes apparent when Mary responds to the angels, look, they have taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him. My friends, the reason that Mary is so upset is because she has not been able to comprehend the resurrection. She doesn't believe that Jesus is alive, but she thinks that while he was dead in the tomb, that his enemies have come and rolled the stone away and stolen his body. And on some level, all of us can identify with the position that Mary finds herself. Mary is so consumed with grief that she has lost her sense of reality. And you know, brothers and sisters, there are times that we get so encumbered in our pains and problems that we forget the promises of God. There are some times that we are so encumbered by misery and mystery that we lose sight of God's miracles. And brothers and sisters, we have to learn a lesson from Mary, because we can never get so encompassed with grief that we forget to shout about the good news of the gospel. Well, this become evident in the next verse. In verse 15, the text says, Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where have you laid him, and I will take him away." Notice that Jesus is now speaking to Mary, and she doesn't even recognize who she's talking to. Jesus asked her the same question as the angels: "Woman, why are you weeping?" However, Jesus takes it a step further and asks her, "Whom are you looking for?" Mary believes that she's talking to the gardener. She moves from thinking that the enemies of Jesus taking his body to thinking that maybe the gardener had removed it. And you know, this is significant in this passage, because in the early church, the Christians preached that Jesus had been raised from the dead. But the Jews say, no, he didn't get raised from the dead. But there was some kind of gardener that stole his body that got the Christians all worked up. Oh, but it's here that Mary addresses this so-called gardener, as she's so desperate to find the body, and she unknowingly says to Jesus, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Mary is so focused on the crucified Christ that she doesn't even recognize the risen Savior. If I could be honest, as I worked on this passage this week, I begin to feel convicted as a pastor, because I begin to wonder how many times does Jesus cross our path and we don't even know who he is. How many times does Jesus walk in the doors of our church and we don't even recognize when he walks in? Sometimes we get so busy with mess that we miss the Messiah. Sometimes we get so busy with church work that we miss Christ. Sometimes we get so encumbered with jealousy that we miss Jesus. Oh, my brothers and sisters, we can't allow our situations to cause us not to recognize the Savior. Oh, but the passage says in verse 16, Jesus said to her, "Mary," as she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. One of the most compelling aspects of this passage is that Jesus never tells Mary directly who he is. Oh, but there's something about the way he calls her name, and Mary knows exactly who she's talking to. Oh, it reminds me of the time that I was a little boy and I thought I was old enough to ride the elevator by myself. And although I had been in the elevator many times, I never noticed that you had to push the button to go to the floor that you wanted to go to. And so I got in the elevator and I was sitting there, and I began to panic because I didn't notice that the elevator was moving. I didn't know what to do. And just before I lost my mind, I heard a voice on the other side of the elevator that says, "Son, you got to push the button." And nobody had to tell me who that voice was, because when I heard the voice, I knew that was my daddy. And this must have been the way that Mary felt, because when she heard Jesus call her name, nobody had to tell her who she was talking to. But when she heard him call her name, She knew that she was talking to the Savior. Isn't it good to know today that everything can change when Jesus calls our name? How many know that when he calls your name, you can go from hurting to healing? When he calls your name, you can go from calmness to confusion. When he calls your name, you can move from triumph to and leave the turmoil behind you. Isn't it good to know today that when Jesus calls our name, that he'll make everything all right? And so when Mary returns, she calls him Rabboni, which in the Aramaic means teacher. And you know, the funny thing about this word is that when it's vocalized, it's a word that really addresses God. And so after Mary witnesses the crucifixion, after she sees the empty tomb, and now she's talking to Jesus, she responds by confessing that he is Lord. It's in the next verse that it appears that Mary tries to touch Jesus. However, Jesus responds to Mary by saying, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father." The phrase "to hold on" literally means to cling to. And so what Jesus is saying to Mary is that I know you see me right now, but don't cling on, because I'm not going to stay here forever. In fact, in 50 days, I'm going to ascend back to the Father. And so don't cling so tightly that you don't be aware that I only have 50 more days before I go back to the Father. And it's at the beginning of verse 17 that Jesus turns Mary's mission into a commission. He says, "Look, but go to my brothers and say to them, I'm ascending to the Father, your Father, and my Father. I'm ascending to my God and your God." Notice that it's here that Jesus really spells out the significance of his death and resurrection. And he sends Mary as the first person to be an eyewitness to the resurrection, as she goes and she tells the disciples, "Let me tell you that Jesus is alive and well. Let me tell you that he's going to ascend to the Father. And let me tell you that he's going to ascend to God." And so Mary takes off. And it's in the last verse, verse 18, that Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them everything that he told her to tell them. Now notice that Mary is faithful to the Lord's commission by letting other people know that she has seen the risen Lord. And Mary is willing to take Jesus at his word and let others know that although they crucified him on Friday, that today he's alive and well. In closing, this commission is not just for Mary. But once we've experienced the Lord, we have to go and tell others that we have seen the Lord. Oh, we might not see him with our physical sight, but when we look back over our lives, we ought to see God's hand at work through every moment of our life. And then we have the commission to fulfill by letting others know that our God is not dead, but God is alive. Reminds me of the time that a little boy born with Down syndrome attended a third grade Sunday school class. The class was filled with 8-year-old boys and girls. And typical of children that age, they didn't readily accept the little boy with his differences. But because of a creative teacher, they begin to care about the little boy and accept him as part of the group, though not fully. The Sunday after Easter, the teacher brought legs, pantyhose containers, the kind that looked like little eggs. And each student received one of the containers. And the children were told to go outside on that lovely spring day and find some kind of symbol for new life and put it in the little egg and bring it back to class. And after running around the church property in wild confusion, the students returned to the classroom and placed their containers on the table. And surrounded by the children, the teacher began to open all of the little eggs. One after one, they had some kind of symbol that symbolized life. One child brought a flower. One brought a butterfly. One brought a leaf. And as each of the little eggs were opened, the class were ooh and ah. Then the teacher got to one egg, and she opened it, and there was nothing inside. The children say, "Look, whose egg is this? What in the world were they thinking? They didn't even do the assignment." And suddenly the little boy spoke up. He said, "That's my egg." And one of the children looked at him and said, "That's just like you. You don't ever do anything right. You didn't even go out and do the assignment." The little boy responded, "No, I did the assignment, but my egg is empty." The teacher said, "Why is your egg empty?" He said, "Because on that Easter morning, when they went to the grave, it was empty, and Jesus was not inside." And from that moment, they started to accept the little boy. And the sad part of the story is a few months later, the little boy died. And when they were sitting at his funeral, all of his classmates walked to the front of the church. And they didn't have flowers in their hand. But one by one, they put a little empty egg right on top of his casket. And I can see them saying today that because the egg is empty, it means the tomb is empty. And because the tomb is empty, that although you died right now, this is not the end of the story. Because one day Jesus is coming back. And when he comes back, your casket will be empty. Your grave will be empty. Because those who sleep in Christ will rise with Christ. Isn't it good to know today that we serve a risen Savior? And because he's risen, it means all things are possible. Because he's risen, it means all sickness is not to death. Because he's risen, it means that God will provide. I heard the hymn this day that God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died just to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there just to prove my Savior lives. Oh, because he lives. I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Oh, and life is worth the living just because Jesus lives. As we come on this Easter morning, there is no time like the present to have a relationship with Christ. It's good to know that when we have that relationship, that when Christ returns, that we will be resurrected just like he is. Maybe you've never had a relationship with Christ. And if that's you today, we invite you into relationship. I tell you that there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. If you never invited him in, won't you do so today? He'll make your life brand new. Maybe you're looking for a church home. I'll be the first to admit Morris Brown is not a perfect church. Mark Brown does not have a perfect pastor. Oh, but we believe in the resurrection. And because we believe in the resurrection, it means that all things become possible. Maybe you have started out on this journey, but you become derailed somewhere along the way. I'm so glad that Jesus can put us back on the right track and have us heading in the right direction. If you find yourself either wanting a relationship with Christ, looking for a church home, or want greater commitment, won't you reach out to us through our website or call our church, and we'll be happy to make this journey together. God, we thank you for those right now who are making the decision to invite you in, making the decision to join the church, making a decision to increase their commitment. Continue to bless all of us and let us do what you would have us to do. It's these things we ask in the name of Jesus we pray. Let the church say, amen. And my brothers and sisters, we come to a significant time in our worship experience on this stewardship moment. Stewardship is very important in the life of a believer because stewardship is our response to the goodness and grace of God. One part of stewardship is financial stewardship. It's that part where we are able to give back to God what God has entrusted to us. And we do this in three ways. The first way we do it is through the tithe. The tithe is the 10% that actually belongs to God. And it's our faithful opportunity to give that back. Another way we do it is through the offering. It's on top of the tithe. And it's that part that we give on top of what belongs to God to say, God, thank you for your goodness. And the last way we have to give is through capital campaigns. And surely we're in a capital campaign right now to pay off the mortgage of our church so that we'll be able and free to do more ministry and be more impactful in our community. Now, I want to thank those who have continued to give, for truly there are a number of people who are being faithful even in the midst of the pandemic. There are three ways that we're able to give. The first is to go online, go to the website that's on your screen, and there will be directions there on how to give. The second way is to text to give by texting MBAMEC 1866 to 888-364-4483. That's on your screen. That's another way to give. And lastly, you can simply mail it to the church, to Morris Ryan AME Church, 13 Morris Street, Charleston, South Carolina, 29403. Lord, we thank you for the gifts that we are receiving. Bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, so happy to have this time together today as we are here to celebrate the resurrection of Christ on Easter. May we go out and live in a way that the world may know that our God lives. Now receive this benediction now unto him who showed up able to keep you from falling, to present you faultless before a stroke of exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, now and forever we pray. Let the church say,
let the church say amen.